The American Embassy, London. Passers-by were asked what the Battle of Britain meant to them.
Well, a great deal. I wouldn't be here if it hadn't been for it.
Saved our country, didn't it?
I feel America had to have something to do with you know, England's victory and the world's victory, and it wasn't totally an English victory.
We felt very proud of the British at that time. We thought they did a tremendous thing for the whole free world.
I really can't remember, and I should have loved history when I read it, but I don't have a retentive mind at all. I wish I did remember.
What do you think about the American Independence War? No?
Battle of Britain. Gosh, I don't know.
The name itself, perhaps we know it under a different name.
Certainly to me, it was one of the greatest things at that time. Kept everybody's spirits up and eventually brought us into the conflict where we should have been much earlier.
I really don't think I should make any comments. I am an employee of the embassy, and I don't think that we really should make any comments about anything.
Right. Hey, flight, scramble!
That happened 6, maybe 7 times a day on English airfields for 14 weeks during the long, hot summer of 1940. In New York, the Giants were playing the Phillies, and I was playing right here in London's East End. It got pretty badly knocked about during the war. In fact, it's a wonder there's anything left standing. Well, that hasn't changed much. But this has. Nowadays, they talk about swinging London, but it wouldn't be very swinging, and there wouldn't be much London either, if it hadn't been for the courage of a very few young pilots who fought it out in the skies 4 miles up above the island of Britain.
And the German army invaded Poland. In less than a year, it brutally forced its way through from Poland to Denmark, Norway, Holland, and Belgium. In May 1940, Hitler struck at France. In northern France at that time, British Hurricane squadrons were reinforcing the French airfields. Now, as the German invader came blitzkrieging its way nearer, they were under constant attack.
Come on, idiot!
Get that bugger out of here! We're going where we've got!
less than 2 weeks over in France, we had lost 250 vital Hurricane aircraft. Air Chief Marshal Sir Hugh Dowding, Chief of Britain's Air Defences, now wrote a letter to the newly appointed Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, which was to decide Britain's course of action.
I must therefore request that not one more fighter be sent across the Channel. If the home defense is drained away in desperate attempts to remedy the situation in France, defeat in France will involve the final, complete, and irremediable defeat of this country.
Churchill's every instinct was to fight on for his old friend, France. But he realized the bitter sense of Dowding's words. No more aircraft were sent to France. 2 weeks later, the Germans forced the British Army off the beaches at Dunkirk. Britain stood alone, completely surrounded, but determined to resist.
What General Weygand has called the Battle of France is over. The Battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. Upon it depends our own British life and the long continuity of our institutions and our empire. Soul, fury, and might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be freed. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age.
But Hitler, with most of Europe now under his domination, was convinced that the isolated British would ask for peace. July 16th, 1940, and with Britain's defiant rejection of his favorable peace terms, Hitler put into gear Operation Sea Lion, the invasion of the British Isles. Luftwaffe, under Hermann Göring, was given the vital preliminary job of driving the Royal Air Force out of the skies. But all this happened nearly 30 years ago. And now the Battle of Britain is being fought all over again for a film.
Stand by for turnover.
Film producers Harry Saltzman, master showman of the James Bond successes, and Ben Fish, himself a Polish fighter pilot during the war, set themselves the task of recreating the battle for the cinema. Together, these two agreed their first rule: absolute truth to reality, down to the very last detail, and no false dramatics. Indeed, the whole drama was already there. A previous Saltzman movie had been Goldfinger. Now, its director, Guy Hamilton, was given the task of interpreting the Battle of Britain onto film. Personifying key diplomatic representatives are Sir Ralph Richardson and Germany's Kurt Jurgens.
I was a young man.
Three squadron commanders, Robert Shaw, Christopher Plummer, and someone who looks very familiar, Trevor Howard as Air Vice Marshal Park, Sir Michael Redgrave, Air Vice Marshal Evil, and Sir Laurence Olivier as Lord Dowding, the Chief of Fighter Command. Now aged 86, Dowding visits his old office rebuilt for the film. He meets Sir Laurence Olivier.
How are you?
Well, this does bring back old days, doesn't it?
That's why I've been sitting pretending to be you. You're making a very great mess of it, too.
Oh, I'm sure.
Dowding had been desperately short of fighters after Dunkirk. But it was even worse for the filmmakers 30 years later. To film the Battle of Britain without the genuine aircraft was unthinkable. But where nowadays could one find enough planes to make this possible? The film's appointed plane finder, Group Captain Hamish Mahady, had spent 2.5 years searching all over the world.
Many of the planes I found were visually out of character with the early machines of 1940. This was the very last Spitfire and built 5 years after the Battle of Britain. So the first thing I had to do was to replace the 5-bladed propeller and rip out the 4 cannon to make way for the 8 machine guns of the battle. The only remaining Spitfire to have fought in the Battle of Britain, I managed to trace and acquired for the film. Although Hurricanes outnumbered Spitfires 2-1 during the battle, they were very much harder to find. To look at a skeleton like this, it's difficult to believe that soon it will be flying again. Ex-service fitters gave up their job, one coming all the way from Poland, to lavish the care and attention that the Spitfires and Hurricanes now demanded. I find it now very rewarding to walk round and see these aircraft, each one a story in itself, how I managed to get hold of them or put them under contract.
Spain had provided the fighters and bomber force to be flown as the Luftwaffe. And representing the Royal Air Force, every available Spitfire and Hurricane still in existence. Together, for the first time, they combined to form the 35th largest air force in the world. Spain comes into the picture. Spain gave them the use of a military airfield outside Seville and allowed her own air force of Messerschmitts and Heinkels to be painted up in German colors for the defeat of Britain. For defeat, it almost certainly must have been had Hitler and Göring listened to Field Marshal Erhard Milch. The man who, as head of Lufthansa when the Nazis seized power, had been asked to form the Luftwaffe and became number two to Göring. Flying over the evacuated Dunkirk beaches, Milch had a plan to win the war.
Göring and Herr Schoening were together with me, and I told them that it would be now the only possibility to go over, now in this moment, immediately after Dunkirk, only with parachutists and also with army divisions, together with Stukas, and then to go to the British airdromes and to take there the gasoline and oil and so on. Göring, he had no time for this and was not interested in. It was for him too dangerous, the idea to go to England with parachutists. Göring had the feeling that the war was over and won. He feared Hitler. He had the feeling if he told Hitler anything against his own opinion, then he was over. Hitler was in this question much more dangerous than I believed. Perhaps otherwise I would not have been sometimes so naughty.
He has been found guilty of using slave labor and of cruel experiments on POWs. His sentence, here it is.
It is the sentence of this tribunal that the defendant, Erhard Milch, be confined to the Rebdorf prison for the remainder of his natural life.
Milch was released 16 years later, and in 1962 went back to business. Impatiently, through June and July 1940, Luftwaffe crews ringing Britain from Norway to the Bay of Biscay itched for the action Milch demanded. To keep up this eagerness while Hitler hesitated, Milch inspected his eager crews much as Dietrich Froebus, playing the part of Milch, carried out his inspection on the film's Spanish airfield.
And
the 35th largest air force in the world had been assembled for the film. Now, it was up to the director, Guy Hamilton.
When we fought the Battle of Britain, it was against invasion, which meant invasion of Britain by Nazism. And had that invasion been successful, we wouldn't have been occupied by a lot of charming Germans. We would have been occupied by Hitlerism and everything that means. The future of Europe and the whole world would have been altered. And I think that has to be stated because it's the reason that Britain fought and fought hard.
Eggenauer?
Dover. I realized that beyond the responsibility of making a good picture, I had the responsibility, a responsibility to history. I'm not a historian, and then I started to get nervous and worried. The more research I did, the more people I met, the more people I interviewed, the more documents I found, I began to develop feelings about the battle, points that I wanted to bring out, and I felt, am I justified in expressing my own opinion? And for about 3 months, I was worried. saying, is it right for a director to look at the Battle of Britain from his own personal point of view? I wrestled with this for a long time and finally felt that the answer was yes. Right. One has to take a viewpoint and one has to bend the scenes to illustrate the feelings that I have about the battle, to destroy the myth, only to recreate a greater myth, because it's a fantastic story. The audience in the cinemas today wouldn't be sitting there looking at it if it hadn't been for the events that happened in a short period of about 12 weeks, 25 years ago.
A first draft script was written, then the experts were brought in to check every small accuracy of detail. Wing Commander Stanford Tuck, British fighter ace, and General Galland, his former opponent, now a close personal friend. During the war, Galland was made a general at only 30 years of age, the youngest general in Europe since Napoleon.
General Galland is in a difficult position vis-à-vis the Battle of Britain because he's a most distinguished figure in Germany, and rightly so. And I think Galland's original attitude to the whole project is that he'd rather not see the picture made at all. It's not a particularly distinguished part of German history. And Galland said, why don't you make the picture of the last noble knights of the air, the last clean fight between two air forces? There'll never be another one in the history of mankind, because now it's all an electronic warfare. This was gentleman to gentleman stuff in the air, to which I replied, rubbish.
I insisted on historical truth, and I insisted on facts like shooting Royal Air Force pilots on the parachute over England. But to the best of my knowledge and the knowledge of all people I have asked, and all people of which I involved, never has happened.
Well, you can't have asked Flight Lieutenant Bowery.
One of my Polish officers called out that he was bailing out. Almost immediately, two Messerschmitts started to attack him whilst he was on his parachute.
This sort of argument went on for months. But finally, the script was agreed, and General Galland found himself in Spain. He knew it well. Over 30 years ago, he had led a German air squadron in the Spanish Civil War, a war in which many Luftwaffe pilots received, well, a kind of training.
Of course, there's a funny feeling, and a lot of memories are coming back. Sometimes you believe the last 20 years are coming back, or have never gone.
Now, the aircraft of both sides stood ready to fight the new Battle of Britain. Jeff Hawke, a British pilot living in Miami, had his World War II American B-25 bomber converted into a flying camera platform in order to film the forthcoming air battles. The B-25 flew out of Florida, gleaming silver. They made her up and fitted her out with cameras in England. And now, as Jeff Hawke taxied her into the Spanish airport, she was ready to start filming. The plane is painted in a variety of colors so that the large formations of Heinkels, Messerschmitts, Hurricanes, and Spitfires can fly in the positions needed for the four cameras. Each camera position has a closed-circuit television set up with videotape recording for instant replay. As you can see, the camera in the tail is completely open to the elements, so the cameraman has to, well, be well strapped in. Taking her up on a trial run, pilot Jeff Hawke puts her through her paces.
It's fun to fly this aircraft. It's been lightened and strengthened considerably for the filming, and behaves a lot more like a fighter than a bomber, which it was originally designed for.
Funny looking sombreros, all the way from Texas. Four Texans, pilots in the privately formed Confederate Air Force, found themselves in Spain.
We bought four Messerschmitts in Spain and Spitfire in England, and before we had time to take them home, we heard about this movie, and they needed both Messerschmitts and Spitfires, so we just leased them to the movie company, and in order for them to lease our airplanes, we made a provision that we fly them.
Leading the American and Spanish pilots in the film is Comandante Santa Cruz, Spain's chief test pilot, who during the war flew with the Spanish Blue Squadron alongside the Luftwaffe and against the Russians.
The double ship will come back, and then you will be able to make a normal formation with the changes.
Right. Okay. Ready?
Good. Go.
The end of July 1940, and Hitler at last ordered Goering to get the Air Force ready to finish off Britain. For nearly 8 weeks since the evacuation of Dunkirk, the Luftwaffe had been attacking harbours and bombing ships at sea. It had met little opposition.
England sind folgende Flieger auf dem. Manson, Biggin, Kenley.
Britain's mere 400 fighters now faced more than 2,500 fighters and bombers across the English Channel. Goering assured Hitler that given four fine days, the Luftwaffe would blast the Royal Air Force out of the skies. And the German crews were just as confident. Impatiently, in early August, they awaited the code word Eagle Day, the descent of the Eagles, which in a matter of days would put pay to Britain for all time. In England, nothing much seemed to have happened for months, not since the army got back from Dunkirk. Air Chief Marshal Dowding wanted to keep what planes and pilots he had. Only token resistance was allowed, even to convoy attacks. Pilots just had to wait. Summer sport, as usual. But horse racing was suddenly banned. Outrageous. Lord Willoughby de Broke, as a top man in the operations room, had split feelings about it.
Having been a member of the Jockey Club for nearly 25 years, and having done two terms of office as a steward, it's very interesting to me to be able to compare this approximate odds totalizator board with the board that faced the controller down in the underground operations room at 11 Fighter Group at Uxbridge. One was sitting in a glass-fronted, soundproof box overlooking a large map of the southeast coast of England and the Channel and the northeast coast of France. Opposite us was the board which showed the state of readiness and preparedness of all our fighter squadrons at their various sector stations.
The squadron leader came into the operations room and he stood there and he surveyed the women in front of him. And in a voice that I shall never forget, he thundered, "Flight Sergeant, get these bloody women out of here." And from that moment, we were soldiers.
Clara Legg, now the wing commander, was one of the first women to be sent down into the operations room. But it wasn't until as late as 1940 that someone decided that women could do the job of plotting.
Now, this was the 11 Group operations room. It was the nerve center of the Battle of Britain. And the decision that came from this particular room was which sector would react and with what force to meet that raid. Perhaps I can set the scene, the sector scene. The table is empty. There's a buzz, a slight buzz. When suddenly the one plotter, and there was only one, on the radio location line, peels her headset. Something's coming. The first plot goes down on the table and they start to build up. The plots came nearer and their direction was more defined. And then it came. A and B squadrons scramble, scramble. A few directions led the fighters towards the enemy. And then we heard the famous word, tally-ho, tally-ho, and all hell was let loose. Everybody seemed to talk at once. It was people shouting instructions and the leader shouting and everybody talking as they went into the kill. And undoubtedly, those girls not only heard language, which perhaps they would prefer not to hear, but they also heard their own friends not replying to a call or calling out that they were going down. Although the winning of that battle was undoubtedly very greatly, almost entirely, to those pilots, had there not been radio location, history could well have told a different story.
These vital radar stations were the number one targets for German attacks. Without radar, there would have only been the good eyes of the Observer Corps, all very fine, in fine weather.
Those Heinkel are 15,000. Still going north.
Were direct hits on radar stations. Disastrous at the time and dangerous to reconstruct for the film.
Now very still.
What's your flag smoke going?
6-3-7, take one.
Ready. Action.
Hostile 2-4-2-0, now at 5-0-6.
Enhance everybody.
Hostile 1-6-40+, now at 10. Hostile 2-3.
And then, just as it seemed that every one of these key radar stations would be bombed off the air, Goering switched his main attack to the frontline airfields, giving time for England to repair and put her radar back into action. It was a very great mistake. Goering had fatally underestimated the importance of radar. The airfields now took the bashing. And through it all, crews had to land, rearm, fuel up, and take off again. The pressure was tremendous. The Royal Air Force, reinforced by volunteer pilots of many nationalities, including some whose countries had been overrun by Germany, was suffering losses of up to 10 planes a day. In August, waves of up to 300 German bombers and fighters attacked southeast England. Pilots were now going up with only a few hours flying experience. Their their life expectancy could be counted in days. The Luftwaffe was determined to destroy Britain's entire fighter force in the air and on the ground.
Given the all clear, we came out to what then appeared incredible devastation. One of the hangars had gone, and of course there were terrible holes in the middle of the runway. Now, I don't think any of us were really frightened until the rumor went around the trench that a piece of shrapnel had cut off one of the WAF's head. And it was at that moment that one got that terrible, terrible squeezy feeling.
While the battle in the air raged on, a new battle had started on the ground between Air Vice Marshals Lee Mallory and Park. A bitter argument had grown up over the tactics being used to fight the enemy.
As bad as we thought, sir.
Worse. Kenny and Biggin are a shambles again, and the rest are not much better. God knows how many aircraft we'll have in the morning. All because 12 Group didn't do their stuff. Lee Mallory and his so-called big wings may as well stand on the ground.
We were up, sir, trying to knock out the enemy en masse. But it takes time to assemble 40 or 50 aircraft at 15,000 feet.
It takes far too long. By the time your big wing is up, the enemy have hit their targets and are on their way home.
All that matters is to shoot them down in large numbers. I'd rather destroy 50 after they've hit their targets than 10 before.
Don't forget the targets are my airfields, Lee Mallory. And you're not getting 50, you're not even getting 10.
Gentlemen, you're missing the essential truth. We're short of 200 pilots. Those we have are tired, strained, and all overdue for relief. We're fighting for survival. We're losing. We don't need a big wing or a small wing. We need pilots. And a miracle. But I, gentlemen.
Dowding got his miracle. On the night of August the 24th, 170 bombers raided Britain. Up until now, the German objectives had been military. 10 lost their way over London, dropped their bombs, and killed civilians. Churchill ordered immediate retaliation. On the very next night, the Royal Air Force bombed Berlin. This is San Sebastian, a well-known seaside town on the north coast of Spain. Its avenues look so like the Berlin streets of 1940 that it was here that the filmmakers decided to reenact the RAF's historic first raid on a German city. They moved in, lighting and dressing the streets and people to become Berlin and the Berliners.
I've always found that make the crowd jolly, make them happy, because then they listen. Don't yell at them, make them feel that they're contributing. So that on the first rehearsals, make it fun. Now's the time to get the acting bit. The quickest way of stopping them laughing is to say as they run past camera, anybody who's seen laughing, I will collect them at the other end and they will be sent home without being paid. And immediately we got a second take with very serious faces.
Hitler was outraged, his capital bombed. He ordered Goering to flatten London. This diverted bombers from our British airfields. The pressure was relieved, the prayer answered. Travelling in his plushy private train, the former First World War fighter ace, now the Luftwaffe's commander-in-chief, Hermann Goering, played by German musical comedy star, Hein Ries, arrives for the first time on the French coast and is greeted by his senior commanders.
One has to be fairly careful with Goering because he really was a half-wit in his behavior, a clown, a comedian. Some of the material we have on Goering you cannot show on the screen.
I saw him once. He had this sky blue uniform and pink boots. He was a man who was always on a stage, exaggerating everything, his clothes, his behavior. And when you were impressed, then he might have impressed you. But when you were not, his effect was rather ridiculous, you know.
Goering felt confident. Everything seemed to be going his way. On the beaches and in the channel ports of France, the military invasion of Britain was being got ready. Operation Sea Lion, they called it. Goering, of course, thought the Luftwaffe could do the job single-handed. But he went down to have a look at what he called unseaworthy barges and all other naval and military operations. Unnecessary, he thought. The preparations for the film's reenaction of Operation Sea Lion were intense. Quiet Spanish fishing ports and beaches began to buzz with German uniforms and strange barges, steel helmets, guns, the lot.
Okay, right. Turn over. Background action.
It was looking just like the real thing, so you can imagine the effect it had on a returning fishing boat that hadn't been let in on what was happening.
Cut it. Cut it. Ricky, the fishing boat that just crept in, it's got to go. Get it out of picture. Now.
It's a bit off-putting when you see a great crowd of Spanish extras dressed up in German uniforms. Don't forget that we always call about 200 or 300 on the basis that we're going to thin out and use about 100. From that point on, one is hoping to find about 50 well-fitted uniforms, reasonably Germanic-looking soldiers. The tin hat is a big help, and then we carefully select half a dozen for the foreground.
If this invasion is going to be tried at all, it does not seem that it can be long delayed.
The German army stood ready to strike. Only one more thing remained to be done before the barges started across that narrow strip of sea. The Royal Air Force had to be knocked out of the skies. Just a few more days, Goering had promised Hitler, and the Luftwaffe itself would win the war. He looked across the channel at Dover, but London, he thought. London's the shortcut to victory.
Haben wir nicht ein schlechtes Wetter?
Genau.
Ein schlechtes Luftwetter?
Ja, ja.
To watch the Messerschmitts on the balcony of this very house. We used to watch them. Then we used to run to the caves. On one or two occasions, we was a bit slow in running. And they died very low. And they machine gunned us on this balcony.
The bombing of London proper now began. The first big daylight raid was on September the 7th. Followed by night raids that night, and every single night for 53 consecutive nights. Other cities got it worse. Berlin, Dresden, for example. But no other city suffered this consecutive bombing of 53 nights, with, of course, much more to follow.
As I said earlier, it's a wonder so much of London was left standing after all the blitzing it took. Funnily enough, the few unhit streets near my old home are now being pulled down for a housing scheme. The authorities let the film unit in. It was an art director's paradise. Pulling the houses down to make them look as though a bomb had just hit them. And the result is just what Guy Hamilton had been after.
We missed one area because we were in Spain, and the second area were too early for it, and I wasn't satisfied, so we rushed around last Sunday and came across this area which was in demolition. As we're dealing with the Greater London Council and their slum clearance schemes, you have to be in and out very quickly. Even the Battle of Britain must not stop the housing program of the United Kingdom.
Okay, got in first positions, everybody.
At 6 o'clock every night, the warning went.
Oh, yeah.
And my husband used to run down the end of the turning and fetch two ladies to go down the shelter.
With him.
One did have quite a detached feeling, 2 miles above them in the air. Because naturally one felt very much for these Londoners who were really taking the brunt of the battle off us. It was very impressive, and to see the bombs dropping too. The cliffs, the atmosphere was a bit hazy. It somehow gave a more eerie effect to the flashes of the bombs.
So you all used to sort of, have your meal.
Pick up your bits and pieces,
wherever shelter you were going to, or if you were going to stay indoors, and just go and wait for it.
What would they take? I think it's what you can grab. There's no time. It's just what's within reach, because most of them must have been in bed anyway. So it's shirt, pajamas, and probably the clock.
London's Underground Railway, the deepest in the world, provided a nightly shelter for many thousands of Londoners. The law against the use of these stations as shelters was ignored, and very soon the rush for the safety of the platforms far below got to be an every night affair. For the film, they borrowed one of these stations. Posters of the present day were replaced by those of the period, and very soon it was 1940 again.
The siren used to go at 5 o'clock, and I used to get very agitated. My mother used to be most helpful in getting my two children to the Hampstead Tube shelter, where we used to have our allotted place on the station. My place was the weighing machine, but my two children were very lucky in having a bunk, which was allotted, and I think we had to wait quite a few weeks to have our names put down to get this. And today, this has brought it back to my mind, those days when we used to feel that going into the deepest shelter in London, which is Hampstead, was a marvelous place for refuge in our troubled times. Our great delight there was a fruit pie and a cup of tea, which we used to look forward to every evening. I used to have to wash my children twice a day and change their clothing, and it was just impossible to keep clean, partly because the trains were going through the stations, and of course the people used to look out, and we were eating and drinking, and the trains going through, we used to get very dirty.
Here is the midnight news, and this is Alvar Liddell reading it. Up to 10 o'clock, 175 German aircraft had been destroyed in today's raids over this country. Today was the most costly for the German Air Force for nearly a month. In daylight raids, between 350 and 400 enemy aircraft were launched in two attacks against London and southeast England. About half of them were shot down.
In a strange way, they're rather proud to be back in amongst it. They realize now that this film is going to go out to the world, and we can all proudly say it's going to show the toughness, the determination of the Londoner not to be beaten under any circumstances.
We're going to do it again. Everybody.
People say, honestly, how did you go through it? But when I saw that tonight and I saw all that rubble, I thought, well, how did we go through it? When you see all that crater and everything. And I think to myself, well, you'd think your mentality couldn't stand it. But it did, because we survived and we're all right now, ain't we?
Maybe they are. But
In September 1940, with the pressure of battle mounting daily, the strain on the young pilots was immense. One of them was Group Captain Peter Townsend.
I was watching the scene, the arrival at dawn of the pilots to take up their readiness. Readiness was 5 minutes' notice, available was 30 minutes' notice, and then there was another state called standby. And there you had to be sitting strapped in your cockpit. There's no doubt that we were very, very tired. We often slept at dispersal. So this meant that one was on duty 24 hours a day. But in some extraordinary way, we were tremendously stimulated by the whole atmosphere of the battle.
As the battle grew more fierce, the losses of British planes and pilots doubled, then trebled. Could Britain hold out? It was the worst time. Then, by about mid-September, the tide began to turn. For the first time, German losses became unbearable. Goering was furious. The British claimed 2,000 German planes destroyed. He told his Luftwaffe that they had betrayed him.
Sie haben mich nicht nur bitter enttäuscht. Sie haben mich verraten.
On September the 14th, Hitler postponed Operation Sea Lion. 3 days later, it was finally abandoned. Leaving behind a skeleton force on the French coast, Hitler's thoughts now turned from the conquest of Britain eastwards towards the solid earth of Russia. Thousands of Frenchmen, bitter under the German occupation. The knowledge that Britain had held the Germans at bay meant the difference between resignation and mounting resistance. Long years of war lay ahead, but never again during that time would English shores be threatened by invasion. Hitler had tasted defeat for the first time. The Battle of Britain was won, the Luftwaffe's invincibility had been shattered. But the cost of victory to the Royal Air Force had been great. Out of 1,500 pilots who bore the brunt of the battle, a third had given their lives. Nevertheless, these pilots, the few, had kept Britain free and made it the soundest stepping stone to ultimate victory in World War II.